Bill of Rights, Section 1. No person shall be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall any person be denied the equal protection of the laws. What is the significance of the Bill of Rights? Government is powerful. When unlimited, it becomes tyrannical. The Bill of Rights is a guarantee that there are certain areas of a person's life, liberty, and property which governmental power may not touch. What powers of government are limited by the Bill of Rights? All the powers of government are limited by the Bill of Rights. What in general are these powers? The totality of governmental power is contained in three great powers: police power, power of eminent domain, and power of taxation. Why are these powers considered inherent powers? Because they belong to the very essence of government, and without them, no government can exist. A constitution can only define and delimit them and allocate their exercise among various government agencies. A constitution does not grant them. Name one major difference between the guarantees of the Bill of Rights and the guarantees that are found in Article 13 of Social Justice. The Bill of Rights focuses on civil and political rights, whereas Article 13 focuses on social and economic rights. Moreover, the guarantees in the Bill of Rights are generally self-implementing. Example, they can be appealed to even in the absence of implementing legislation. On the other hand, the social and economic rights guaranteed in Article 13, as also recognized in Article 2, generally require implementing legislation. What is police power? Police power has been characterized as the most essential, insistent, and the least limitable of powers, extending, as it does, to all great public needs. Negatively, it has been defined as that inherent and plenary power in the state which enables it to prohibit all that is hurtful to the comfort, safety, and welfare of society. Safely? Ermita Malate Hotel and Motel Operations or Association versus Mayor of Manila. What is the scope of police power? Police power rests upon public necessity and upon the right of the state and of the public to self-protection. For this reason, its scope expands and contracts with changing needs. Churchill versus Rafferty. Who exercises police power? The national government, through the legislative department, exercises police power, but police power is also delegated within limits to local governments. Does Metro Manila Development Authority, MMDA, possess police power? Answer, no. Not being a political subdivision, but merely an executive authority, it has no police power. Police power in Metro Manila is exercised by the cities and municipalities. May a municipality be prevented by COA from giving burial assistance to indigents? Police power is a broad concept covering efforts to contribute to the comfort of the public. Moreover, the fact that not all receive the dole out does not make it less public, because the drift of the law is in the direction of public welfare and social justice. Binay versus Domingo. May the state prohibit gambling? The state may do so if it so chooses and make violation a criminal offense, but gambling is not immoral per se. Magtahas versus Price Properties. Is the law ordering the closure of commercial food banks valid? Yes, it is a valid exercise of police power to protect public health. Beltran versus Secretary of Health. ABS-CBN has a legislative franchise to operate television stations. It broadcasts from its Channel 2 and Channel 23. Philippine Multimedia System, PMSI, also has a legislative franchise which authorizes it to do so direct-to-home service. Moreover, its franchise includes a mandatory duty to carry the television signals of the authorized television broadcast stations. For that reason, it carries Channel 2 and 23 of ABS-CBN. ABS-CBN contends that PMS, unauthorized rebroadcasting of Channel 2 and 23, is a taking of property for public use without just compensation. Answer. Franchises are subject to police power, and the mandatory rule is not a form of taking but a form of police power regulation. ABS-CBN Broadcasting Corporation versus PMSI, GR 175769-70. What rights are protected by the Bill of Rights? In view of general terms, the right of life, the right to life, liberty, and property, the manner of protecting these is elucidated in subsequent sections. What is the right to life? The constitutional protection of the right to life is not just a protection of the right to be alive or to the security of one's home against physical harm. The right to life is the right to a good life. The emphasis on the quality of living is found in Article 2, where Section 6 commands the state to promote a life of dignity, and where Section 7 guarantees a decent standard of living. Do the unborn have a constitutional right to life? Article 2, Section 12. What does property include? Protected property includes all kinds of property found in the Civil Code. It has been deemed to include vested rights, such as perfected mining claim, or a perfected homestead, or a final judgment. It also includes the right to work and the right to earn a living. A license to operate a cockpit is not considered protected property. It is deemed merely a privilege, withdrawable when public interest requires its withdrawal. In like manner, it has been ruled that a certificate of public convenience granted to a transportation company confers no property right on the route covered thereby. A mere privilege, however, may evolve into some form of property right protected by due process, as for instance, when a privilege, in this case an export quota, has been enjoyed for so long, has been the subject of substantial investment, and has become the source of employment for thousands. American Interfashion Corporation versus Office of the President. Is one's employment, profession, or trade property protected by the Constitution? Yes. Does an order of preemptive suspension without opportunity for hearing at all violate property right? Crispo versus Provincial Board. A law limiting deployment of overseas workers to skilled workers only was challenged as violative of the right to work. Decide. No right is absolute, and the proper regulation of a profession, calling, business, or trade has always been upheld as a legitimate act of a valid exercise of the police power by the state, particularly when their conduct affects either the execution of legitimate governmental functions, the preservation of the state, the public health and welfare, and public morals. Executive Secretary versus CA. May the license of harbor pilots be canceled without a hearing? No. Corona versus United Harbor Pilots Association of the Philippines. Do life and property enjoy identical protection from the Constitution? No. The primacy of human rights over property right is recognized. In the hierarchy of civil liberties, the rights of free expression and of assembly occupy a preferred position, as they are essential to the preservation and vitality of our civil and political institutions. The superiority of these freedoms over property rights is underscored by the fact that a mere reasonable or rational relation between the means employed by the law and its object or purpose, that the law is neither arbitrary nor discriminatory nor oppressive, would suffice to validate a law which restricts or impairs property rights. On the other hand, a constitutional or valid infringement of human rights requires a more stringent criterion, namely existence of a grave and immediate danger of a substantive evil which the state has the right to prevent. Philippine Blooming Mills Employee Organization versus Philippine Blooming Mills. Glaxo Wellcome has a policy against employees marrying employees of competitor companies. This is well known to and is accepted by employees. An employee who, after repeated warnings, violated this rule by marrying an employee of Astra, a competitor company, was dismissed. He challenges the policy of a violation of the right to marry. Decide. Glaxo has a right to guard its trade secrets, manufacturing formulas, marketing strategies, and other confidential programs and information from competitors. Glaxo and Astra are rival companies in a highly competitive pharmaceutical industry. Duncan Association of Employees versus Glaxo Wellcome, where, however, there is no reasonable necessity for the prohibition. It is illegal. Star Paper versus Symbol. What is the nature of the right to collect from a pension plan? In a pension plan where employee participation is mandatory, the prevailing view is that employees have contractual or vested rights in the pension where the pension is part of the terms of employment. Thus, where the employee retires and meets the eligibility requirements, he acquires a vested property right to benefit that is protected by the Due Process Clause, DSIS versus Monte Claros. A law that orders discontinuance of a pension of a retired military officer if he becomes a citizen of another country was held not to violate equal protection. Pension of military retirees is purely gratuitous. Perennio versus COA. Q. The military detainees question the correctness of the restriction on contact visits. Answer. Block B. Rutherford, which reiterated Bell v. Wolfish, upheld the blanket restriction on contact visits as this practice was reasonably related to maintaining security. Contact visits make it possible for the detainees to hold visitors and jail staff hostage to effect escapes. Contact visits also leave the jail vulnerable to visitor smuggling in weapons, drugs, and other contraband. The security consideration in the imposition of blanket restriction on contact visits was ruled to outweigh the sentiments of the detainees in the matter of petition for habeas corpus, GR 160792. Moreover, where the only limitation imposed upon police officers is that their movements within the premises of the camp shall be monitored, that they have to be escorted whenever the circumstances warrant that they leave the camp, and that their estimated time of departure and arrival shall be entered in a logbook, there is no deprivation of liberty. Malala versus PNP. Do people have the right to bear arms? No. Only those authorized by law may bear arms. Even the provision in the American Constitution has reference only to a collective right of militia to bear arms. No similar provision is found in our Constitution. United States versus Villarreal. Travis versus Executive Secretary, GR 157036. Two kinds of due process. What are the two aspects of due process? Due process has both a procedural and a substantive aspect. As a substantive requirement, it is a prohibition of arbitrary laws, because if all that the due process clause required were proper procedure, then life, liberty, or property could be destroyed arbitrarily, provided proper formalities are observed. As a procedural requirement, it relates chiefly to the mode of procedure which government agencies must follow in the enforcement and application of laws. It is a guarantee of procedural fairness. Its essence was expressed by Daniel Webster as a law which hears before it condemns. Procedural due process in courts in non-criminal cases. Q. What are the essential requirements of procedural due process in courts? These are: 1. There must be a court or tribunal clothed with judicial power to hear and determine the matter before it. 2. Jurisdiction must be lawfully acquired over the person of the defendant or over the property which is the subject of the proceedings. 3. The defendant must be given an opportunity to be heard. And 4. Judgment must be rendered upon lawful hearing. Banco Español, Filipina versus Palanca. Procedural due process in criminal cases is treated in Section 14 below. The details of procedural due process for both criminal and non-criminal cases are spelled out in the rules of court. Does an extraditee have a right to access the evidence against him? During the executive phase of an extradition proceeding, an extraditee does not have the right to access to evidence in the hands of government, but during the judicial phase, he has. Secretary versus Judge Lantillo. Does a teacher in a school administrative proceeding have a right to be assisted by counsel? Yes. Due process demands this. Gonzalez versus NLRC in Ateneo de Davao. When is a law so vague as not to satisfy the due process need for notice? It is vague when it lacks comprehensible standards that man of common intelligence must necessarily guess as to its meaning, and differs as to its application. It is repugnant to the Constitution in two respects. 1. It violates due process for failure to accord persons, especially the parties targeted by it, fair notice of the conduct to avoid. And 2. It leaves law enforcers unbridled discretion in carrying out its provisions and becomes an arbitrary flexing of the government muscle. But to be unconstitutional, the law must be utterly vague on its face. That is to say, it cannot be clarified by either a saving clause or by construction. People versus Nazario. A statute is not rendered uncertain and void merely because general terms are used therein, or because of the employment of terms without defining them. Much less do we have to define every word we use. Besides, there is no positive constitutional or statutory command requiring the legislature to define each and every word in an enactment. The plunder law, under which former President Estrada is being prosecuted, is not vague. The words series and combination of crimes can be understood in their ordinary meaning, Estrada v. Sandigambayan. Article 202 of the Penal Code defines vagrants. Thus, any person found loitering about public or semi-public buildings or places or tramping or wandering about the country or the streets without visible means of support. The law prohibiting vagrancy is challenged as vague. The void for vagueness doctrine holds that a law is facially invalid if men of common intelligence must necessarily guess at its meaning and differ as to its application. This is not such a law. Romualdez v. Comelec. Procedural due process in administrative cases. What are the essential requirements of procedural due process before administrative agency? Briefly, the following are required: the right to actual or constructive notice of the institution of proceedings which may affect a respondent's legal rights; 2. A legal opportunity to be heard personally or with the assistance of counsel, to present witnesses and evidence in one's favor, and to defend one's right; a tribunal vested with competent jurisdiction and so constituted as to afford a person charged administratively a reasonable guarantee of honesty as well as impartiality; and 4. A finding of said tribunal, which is supported by substantial evidence submitted for consideration during the hearing, or contained the records, or made known to the parties affected. Familia v. Court of Appeals. Is publication a requirement of due process? Yes. The rule that requires publication for the effectivity of laws applies not only to statutes, but also to presidential decrees and executive orders promulgated by the president in the exercise of legislative powers, whenever the same are validly delegated by the legislature, or at present directly conferred by the Constitution. Administrative rules and regulations must also be published if their purpose is to enforce or implement existing law, pursuant also to a valid delegation. Republic v. Filipinos shall. Is a respondent in administrative case entitled to be informed of the findings and recommendations of an investigating committee created to inquire into charges filed? No. He is entitled only to the administrative decision based on substantial evidence made of record and a reasonable opportunity to meet the charges and the evidence presented against him during the hearing of the investigation committee. It is the administrative resolution, not the investigation report, which should be the basis of any further remedies that the losing party in an administrative case might wish to pursue. Pefianco v. Moral. What quantum of proof is needed in administrative proceedings? In administrative proceedings, the quantum of proof required is only substantial evidence. Substantial evidence means such relevant evidence as a reasonable mind might accept as adequate to support a conclusion. Are notice and hearing always required in administrative proceedings? In quasi-judicial proceedings, yes, but in the performance of executive or legislative functions, such as issuing internal rules and regulations, an administrative body need not comply with the requirements of notice and hearing. Without conducting any hearing, the National Telecommunications Commission ordered Philcomsat to reduce its rate by 15%. Valid? Changing existing rates is quasi-judicial in nature, hence, it must be preceded by a hearing. The fact of the order being merely interlocutory does not alter the situation because, for all practical purposes, it is final as to the period covered. Philcomsat v. Alcuas, GR 84818. Police officer Torcida was charged on 12 counts of conduct and becoming an officer. The 12 counts were dismissed, but he was convicted of simple irregularity in the performance of duty of having alcohol in his breath. Proper? No. While the definition of the more serious offense is broad and almost all-encompassing, a finding of guilt for an offense, no matter how light, for which one is not properly charged and tried, cannot be countenanced without violating the rudimentary requirements of due process. Summary Dismissal Board v. Torcida. Note, see also cases and schools under Article 14, Section 4. What kind of due process is required in deportation proceedings? Although deportation proceedings are not criminal in nature, the consequences can be as serious as those of a criminal prosecution. The provisions in the rules of court for criminal cases are applicable. Substantive due process. When do laws which interfere with life, liberty, or property satisfy substantive due process? To satisfy the state in interposing its authority in behalf of the public, it must appear 1. That the interests of the public generally, as distinguished from those of a particular class, require such interference, and 2. That the means are reasonably necessary for the accomplishment of the purpose, and not unduly oppressive upon individuals. The legislature may not, under the guise of protecting the public interest, arbitrarily interfere with private business, or impose unusual and unnecessary restrictions upon law. Occupations, United States versus Trivial. Is the requirement of substantive due process a rigid concept? Definitely not. The heart of substantive due process is the requirement of reasonableness or absence of exercise of arbitrary power. These are necessarily relative concepts which depend on the circumstances of every case. What is the presumption when the state acts to interfere with life, liberty, or property? Generally, the presumption is that the action is valid. In rare cases, however, as in the imposition of prior restraint, to be discussed under Section 4, there is a presumption of invalidity. Is the allowable scope of reasonable interference with property the same as that with life or liberty? No. See Philippine Blooming Mills Employees Organization versus Philippine Blooming Mills Supra. Rarely has a law interfering merely with property rights been declared unconstitutional. Ordinance number 4964 of Manila reads, it shall be prohibited for any operator of any barber shop to conduct the business of massaging customers or other persons in any adjacent room or rooms of said barber shop, or in any room or rooms within the same building where the barber shop is located, as long as the operator of the barber shop and the rooms where massaging is conducted is the same person. Does this amount to deprivation of property without due process? No, this is valid exercise of police power under the General Welfare Clause for the Protection of Morals, Velasco versus Mayor Villegas. In an effort to curb immorality, the City of Manila passed an ordinance which disallows the operation of sauna parlors, massage parlors, karaoke bars, beer houses, nightclubs, day clubs, super clubs, disco bars, cabarets, dance halls, motels, and inns in the Ermita Malate. Is it valid? Conceding for the nuns that the Ermita Malate area teems with houses of ill repute and establishments of the like which the city council may lawfully prohibit, it is baseless and insupportable to bring within that classification sauna parlors, massage parlors, karaoke bars, nightclubs, day clubs, super clubs, discotheques, cabarets, dance halls, motels, and inns. This is not warranted under the accepted definitions of these terms. The enumerated establishments are lawful pursuits which are not per se offensive to the moral welfare. City of Manila versus Judge Lagri, DR 118127. A Manila ordinance prohibits motels, etc., from offering short-time admission, as well as prorated or wash-up rates for such abbreviated stays. The ordinance was invalidated as violative of the right to property of motel operators and of liberty of potential clients. The hotel operators were allowed to raise the issue of liberty of clients by appealing to third-party standing, White Light Corporation versus City of Manila. GR 122846. An executive order issued by President Reid. Executive Order Number 626 is hereby amended such that henceforth no carnival, regardless of age, sex, physical condition, or purpose, and no carabif shall be transported from one province to another. The carabao or carabif transported in violation of this executive order as amended shall be subject to confiscation and forfeiture. The original executive order was for prohibiting the slaughter of carabaos, except under certain conditions, for the purpose of preserving them for the benefit of small farmers. Is the amendment valid? No. Outright confiscation is not reasonably related to the purpose. Moreover, it is unduly oppressive. The owner of the property is denied the opportunity to be heard, and the property is immediately confiscated and distributed. Enot versus Intermediate Court of Appeals. May the state prohibit candidates for board examination from attending review classes or similar exercises? The court said that the rule of the Professional Regulatory Commission, which restricts reviewers from attending review classes, briefing conferences, or the like, in receiving any handout, review material, etc., was unreasonable and arbitrary and violative of the academic freedom of school. Lupanco versus Court of Appeals. The City of Butuan issues an ordinance prescribing that children between the ages of 7 and 12 should be charged only half the admission price in movie houses. Is this a valid exercise of police power? No. For the benefit of parents, then the cost is passed on to cinema owners. There is no discernible relation between the ordinance and the promotion of public health, safety, morals, and the general welfare. Balakid versus Court of First Instance. Note, a Texas statute making it a crime for two persons of the same sex to engage in certain intimate sexual conduct was held to violate the Due Process Clause. Petitioners were free as adults to engage in private conduct in the exercise of their liberty under the Due Process Clause. Lawrence v. Texas. Equal Protection. What is the meaning of equal protection of law? The Equal Protection Clause is a specific constitutional guarantee of the equality of the person. The equality it guarantees is legal equality or, as it is usually put, the equality of all persons before the law. Under it, each individual is dealt with as an equal person in the law, which does not treat the person differently because of who he is, or what he possesses. The goddess of justice is portrayed with a blindfold, not because she must be hindered in seeing where the right lies, but that she may not discriminate against suitors before her, dispensing instead an even-handed justice to all. Does equal protection prohibit classification? No, but the classification must be reasonable, and the classification to be reasonable, 1. Must rest on substantial distinctions, 2. Must be germane to the purpose of the law, 3. Must not be limited to existing conditions only, and 4. Must apply equally to all members of the same class. People v. Kayet. RA 7227 is challenged as violative equal protection because it grants tax and duty incentives only to businesses and residents within the secured area of the Subic Special Economic Zone, and denying them to those who live within the zone but outside such fenced-in territory. Decide. The Constitution does not require absolute equality among residents. The real concern of RA 7227 is to convert the lands formerly occupied by the U.S. military bases into economic or industrial areas. In furtherance of such objective, Congress deemed it necessary to extend economic incentives to attract and encourage investors, both local and foreign. TU versus Court of Appeals. GR 127410. Filipino teachers in the international school challenged the legality of the school's practice of giving higher pay to foreign hires than Filipinos of equal rank. Is the practice constitutional? No. The principle of equal pay for equal work requires that persons who work with substantially equal qualifications, skill, effort, and responsibility under similar conditions should be paid similar salaries. While we recognize the need of the school to attract foreign hires, salaries should not be used as an enticement to the prejudice of local hires. The dislocation factor and limited tenure affecting foreign hires are adequately compensated by certain benefits accorded them, which are not enjoyed by local hires, such as housing, transportation, shipping costs, taxes, and home leave travel allowances. International School Alliance of Educators v. Kisumbing. Petitioners theorized that Section 44 of RA 8189 is violative of the Equal Protection Clause because it singles out the city and municipal election officers of the Comelec as prohibited from holding office in the same city or municipality for more than 4 years. Valid? Yes, the singling out of election officers in order to ensure the impartiality of election officials by preventing them from developing familiarity with the people of their place of assignment justifies the distinction. De Guzman Jr. et al. Versus Comelec. A law prescribes that an appointed official who files a certificate of candidacy is considered resigned. The law does not apply to elective officials. Valid? Yes. Appointed officials and elective officials do not belong to the same class. Farinas et al. Versus Executive Secretary. A law provides that in case of termination of overseas employment without just, valid or authorized cause as defined by law or contract, the worker shall be entitled to the full reimbursement of his placement fee with interest of 12% per annum, plus his salaries for the unexpired portion of his employment contract, or for 3 months for every year of the unexpired term, whichever is less. Other employees, however, are given full coverage for the unexpired term. Valid? It is discriminatory against overseas workers in a matter involving fundamental rights. Serrano v. Gallant Maritime Service, GR 167-614. Executive Order No. 1 created the Truth Commission with power to investigate graft and corruption committed during the Arroyo administration. Valid? No. It violates equal protection for focusing only on what happened during the Arroyo administration. Birago v. Truth Commission, GR 192935. Note. A different tax treatment for new brands of cigarettes was justified on the basis of practicality and efficiency, that is, since the new brands were not yet in existence at the time of the passage of R.A.A. 240, then Congress needed a uniform mechanism to fix the tax bracket of a new brand. It is argued that the freeze provision violates the Equal Protection and Uniformity of Taxation Clause because other brands are taxed based on their 1996 net retail prices, while new cigarette brands are taxed based on their present-day net retail prices. The court said that since this is not a case which involves suspect classification nor impinges on fundamental rights, the rational test basis is what is applicable. It has been held that in the areas of social and economic policy, a statutory classification that neither proceeds along suspect lines nor infringes constitutional rights must be upheld against equal protection challenge if there is any reasonable conceivable state of facts that could provide a rational basis for the classification. British American Tobacco v. Camacho, GR 163583. Reconsideration. What is reconsideration? Can a provision of law initially valid become subsequently unconstitutional on the ground that its continued operation would violate the equal protection of the law? Yes. Example, with the passage of the subsequent laws amending the charter of 7 other governmental financial institutions, removing limitations on employees, the continued operation of the limitation on central bank employees under Section 15, letter C, Article 2 of the Central Bank Law constitute invidious discrimination on the 2,994 rank and file employees of the Banco Central ng Pilipinas BSP. This is the case of relative unconstitutionality, Central Bank Employees versus Banco Central, GR 148208. What does the new constitution say about equal rights for women? See Article 2, Section 14. Does PT&T company policy of not accepting or considering as disqualified from work any woman worker who contracts marriage violate women's right against discrimination afforded by the Constitution? Yes. Philippine Telegraph and Telephone Company versus NLRC. The following disqualification for local elective office found in Batas Big 52, Section 4, is challenged as discriminatory. Any retired elected provincial, city, or municipal official who has received payment of retirement benefits to which he is entitled under the law and who shall have been 65 years of age at the commencement of the term of office to which he seeks to be elected shall not be qualified to run for the same elective local office from which he has retired. The provision satisfies all the requirements of valid classification. Dumlao v. Comelec. A law is passed prohibiting women from becoming licensed bartenders. Valid? The object of the law is to protect the morals of women. The physical and psychological differences between men and women make the distinction reasonably related to the valid purpose. Dieussart versus Cleary. A law is passed prohibiting women from becoming teachers valid. No, the distinction between men and women serves no valid purpose. A law is passed requiring courts to give free transcript of records to indigent litigants. Valid? Yes. The classification serves to equalize opportunities in courts between rich and poor. A law is passed prohibiting indigents from running for public office. Valid? No. The discrimination against indigents serves no valid purpose. Ormuc City imposes a tax on Ormuc Sugar Central. By name, Ormuc Sugar Central is the only sugar central in Ormuc City. Valid? No. Should another sugar center arise in Ormuc City, the ordinance would be discriminatory against Ormuc Sugar Central, which alone comes under the ordinance. Ormuc Sugar Central versus Ormuc City. PD 1486, creating the syndicate by it is challenged as violative of the Equal Protection Clause because rights under it, such as right to appeal to the Supreme Court, are listed in other proceedings. Decide. The question here is whether those coming under the special compass of the Sandigan Bayan merit special classification. The constitutional call for the creation of the Sandigan Bayan is a call for a special solution to a special problem. It is already a recognition that dishonesty in public service is a valid basis for classification. The Constitution's call for this special court prevails over general provisions of the Bill of Rights, Nunez versus Sandigan Bayan. January 30, 1982, Bacazier filed an extensive dissent which is worth studying. A law provides that a police officer under investigation may be preventively suspended beyond the usual 90 days and until the case is decided. Does the law deny equal protection of police officers? The special law for police officers is justified by their status. In upholding the provision, the court said that the reason why members of the PNP are treated differently from the other classes of persons, charged criminally or administratively, insofar as the application of the rule in preventive suspension is concerned, is that policemen carry weapons and the badge of the law, which can be used to harass or intimidate witnesses against them, as succinctly brought out in the legislative discussions. Himagan versus People. Does the Equal Protection Clause merely prohibit the state from passing discriminatory laws? No. The clause also commands that the state to pass laws which positively promote equality or reduce existing inequalities. Section 2. The right of people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizure of whatever nature and for any purpose shall be inviolable, and no search warrant or warrant of arrest shall issue except upon probable cause, to be determined personally by the judge, after examination under oath, or affirmation of the complainant and the witnesses he may produce, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. What is the purpose of this provision? The purpose of the provision is to protect the privacy and sanctity of the person in his house and other possessions against arbitrary intrusions by state officers. Does the provision prohibit all searches and seizures? No. What it prohibits are unreasonable searches and seizures. When are searches and seizures unreasonable? Searches and seizures are normally unreasonable unless authorized by a validly issued search warrant or warrant of arrest. Thus, the fundamental protection given by the search and seizure clause is that between person and police must stand the protective authority of a magistrate clause with power to issue or refuse to issue search warrants or warrants of arrest. Is there a presumption of regularity in search cases? No. To prevent stealthy encroachment upon or gradual depreciation of the right to privacy, a liberal construction in search and seizure cases is given in favor of the individual. Sony Music versus Judge Espanol. Does Section 2 of the Bill of Rights protect citizens from unreasonable searches and seizures perpetrated by private individuals? No. The constitutional prescription against unlawful searches and seizures applies as a restraint directed only against the government and its agencies tasked with enforcement of the law. People versus Marty. However, it may be possible to find a remedy in the Civil Code. When does an inquiry become a search, such that it comes under the rule of Section 2? Are checkpoints, for instance, search points? Are checkpoints constitutional? Not all searches and seizures are prohibited. Those which are reasonable are not forbidden. A reasonable search is not to be determined by any fixed formula, but is to be resolved according to the facts of each case. Belmonte v. General de Villa, GR 83988. When are checkpoints allowed? Checkpoints are not illegal per se. Thus, under exceptional circumstances, as where the survival of organized government is on the balance, or where the lives and safety of the people are in grave peril, checkpoints may be allowed and installed by the government. Routine inspection and a few questions do not constitute unreasonable searches. If the inspection becomes more thorough to the extent of becoming a search, this can be done when there is deemed to be a probable cause. In the latter situation, it is justifiable as a warrantless search of a moving vehicle. Belmonte v. General de Villa. Must checkpoints be announced? We see no need for checkpoints to be announced. Not only would it be impractical, it will also forewarn those who intend to violate the ban. Even so, badges of legitimacy of checkpoints may still be inferred from their fixed location and the regularized manner in which they are operated. People v. Escano, GR 129756-58. Is every warrantless search or seizure unreasonable? No. As will be shown later, there are exceptions to the rule. What are the essential requisites of a valid warrant? The following are the requisites. It must be issued upon probable cause. Number 1. Number 2. Probable cause must be determined personally by a judge. 3. Such judge must examine under oath or affirmation the complainant and the witnesses he may produce. 4. The warrant must particularly describe the place to be searched and the person or things to be seized. Probable cause. What is probable cause? Probable cause means such facts and circumstances antecedent to the issuance of a warrant that are in themselves sufficient to induce a cautious man to rely upon them. Specifically, probable cause must be defined in relation to the action which it justifies. Probable cause for the issuance of a warrant of arrest would mean such facts and circumstances which would lead a reasonable, discreet, and prudent man to believe that an offense has been committed by the person sought to be arrested. Probable cause for a search would mean such facts and circumstances which would lead a reasonable, discreet, and prudent man to believe that an offense has been committed and that the object sought in connection with the offense are in the place sought to be searched. Henry v. United States. What kind of evidence is needed to establish probable cause? As implied by the words themselves, probable cause is concerned with probability, not absolute or even moral certainty. The prosecution need not present at this stage proof beyond reasonable doubt. The standards of judgment are those of a reasonable, prudent man, not the exacting calibration of a judge after a full-blown trial. Microsoft Corporation v. MaxiCorp, 140946. Note, to establish probable cause of illegal possession of firearms, the witness must have personal knowledge of the existence of the firearms and of the absence of license for such firearms. Bitoy v. Judge. The affidavit of Colonel Castillo stated that in several issues of the Philippine Times, we found that the said publication, in fact, foments distrust and hatred against the government of the Philippines and its duly constituted authorities defined and penalized by Article 142 of the Revised Penal Code, and the affidavit of Lieutenant Ignacio Reed. The said periodical published by Romel Coro contains articles tending to incite distrust and hatred for the government of the Philippines or any of its duly constituted authorities. Do the affidavits establish probable cause? No, they are nothing but conclusion of law. Coro v. Using, 137 Squa, 541. A search warrant for the newspaper WE firm is issued on the basis of a broad statement of the military that Burgess Jr. is in possession of or has in his control printing equipment and other paraphernalia, news publications, and other documents which were used and are all continuously being used as a means of committing the offense of subversion. Is such allegation sufficient to establish probable cause? No. It is a mere conclusion of law, unsupported by particulars. Burgess Sr. v. Chief of Staff. must prove of probable cause for a warrant point to a specific offender, for a search warrant for things, no, for warrants for arrest, yes. Webb versus De Leon. Who may determine probable cause for the purpose of issuing a warrant? Only a judge. Who determines probable cause for the purpose of filing an information? The prosecution. The determination of probable cause during a preliminary investigation is an executive function. Its correctness is a matter that the trial court itself does not and may not be compelled to pass upon. People versus Court of Appeals. An anonymous caller tipped off police officers that a man and a woman were repacking prohibited drugs at a certain house. The officers immediately proceeded to the house. When they reached the house, they peeped inside through a small window and saw one man and a woman repacking suspected marijuana. They entered the house and confiscated the tea bags and some drugs paraphernalia. Subsequent examination of the tea bags by NBI confirmed the suspicion that the tea bags contained marijuana. Was there a valid search and seizure? No. The state cannot in cavalier fashion intrude into the person of its citizens as well as into their houses, papers, and effects. The constitutional provision protects the privacy and sanctity of the person himself against unlawful arrest and other forms of restraint and prevents him from being irreversibly cut off from that domestic security which renders the lives of the most unhappy in some measure agreeable. People versus Bolosa. May the Commissioner in Immigration issue warrants of arrest? Since the Commissioner in Immigration is not a judge, he may not issue warrants of arrest in aid merely of his investigatory power. However, he may order the arrest of an alien for the purpose of carrying out a deportation order that has already become final. Kyuchigam versus Deportation Board. Where the PCGG issues a search and seizure order, which has all the features of a search warrant, is such order valid? No, because only a judge may issue a search warrant. Besides, in this case, there was no probable cause. Republic versus Sandigan Bayan. What is needed in order to show probable cause of infringement of copyright by renting agencies of cassette tapes? Is the presentation of master tapes required? Not at all time. It is needed only where there is doubt as to the nexus between the master tape and their pirated copies. Columbia Pictures versus CA. What is the meaning of personally and the search and seizure clause? What the Constitution underscores is the exclusive and personal responsibility of the issuing judge to satisfy himself of the existence of the probable cause. In satisfying himself of the existence of the probable cause for the issuance of a warrant of arrest, the judge is not required to personally examine the complainant and his witnesses, and on the basis thereof, issue a warrant of arrest. He may also rely on the fiscal's report, or if on the basis thereof he finds no probable cause, he may disregard the fiscal's report and require the submission of supporting affidavits of witnesses to aid him in arriving at a conclusion as to the existence of probable cause. This means that what is required is personal determination and not personal examination. Sound policy dictates this procedure. Otherwise, judges would be unduly laden with the preliminary examination and investigation of criminal complaints. Note that in the text, the adverb personally modifies determined. Sullivan versus Judge McCassier. Note, a judge is not required to personally examine the complainant and his witnesses or to await the submission of counter affidavits from an accused. Following established doctrine and procedure, the judge shall 1. Personally evaluate the report and the supporting documents submitted by the prosecutor regarding the existence of probable cause, and on the basis thereof, he may already make a personal determination of the existence of probable cause, and 2. If he is not satisfied that probable cause exists, he may disregard the prosecutor's report and require the submission of supporting affidavits of witnesses to aid him in arriving at a conclusion as to the existence of probable cause. Berlongan versus Pifia. To establish probable cause of illegal possession of firearms, the witness must have personal knowledge of the existence of the firearms and of the absence of license for such firearms. Bitter versus Judge. Note, compare this with Bache and Co. case infra. What procedure must be followed in determining probable cause? A judge must examine the complainant and his witnesses under oath or affirmation. This has been interpreted as requiring a personal and not merely delegated examination by the judge or by the proper officer, because the purpose of the examination is to convince the judge or officer himself and not any other individual. Alvarez versus Court. For the purpose of satisfying the requirement of the judge examine under oath the complainant and the witnesses, are affidavits of the complainant and of the witnesses sufficient? No. The examining judge has to take the positions in writing of the complainant and the witnesses he may produce and to attach them to the record. Such written deposition is necessary in order that the judge may be able to properly determine the existence or non-existence of the probable cause, to hold liable for perjury the person giving it if it will be found later that his declarations are false. People versus Mamaril. But the actual taking of the position, etc., may be done by the prosecutor, but it is the judge who evaluates the evidence. Can a judge rely solely on the certification or recommendation of a prosecutor that probable cause exists in issuing a warrant of arrest? No. By itself, the prosecutor's certification of probable cause is ineffectual. The judge must look at the report, the affidavits, transcripts of stenographic notes, if any, and all other supporting documents behind the prosecutor's certification. Lim v. Felix, GR 94054-57. What is the meaning of particularity of description? A search warrant may be said to particularly describe the things to be seized when the description therein is as specific as the circumstances will ordinarily allow and by which the warrant officer may be guided in making the search and seizure. What is the purpose of requiring particularity of description? Its purpose is to prevent abuse by the officer enforcing the warrant by leaving to him no discretion as to who or what to search or seize. Where the warrant describes what is to be seized as an indeterminate amount of marijuana, is it sufficient? Yes, it is required that technical precision of description be required, particularly where, by the nature of the goods to be seized, their description must be rather general, since the requirement of a technical description would mean that no warrant could issue. People versus T. Does a John Doe warrant satisfy the requirement of particularity of description? Yes, provided that it contains a description persona, such as will enable the officer to identify the accused. People versus Peloso. But a warrant of arrest against 50 John Doe's is of the nature of a general warrant, clearly violative of the requirement of particularity of description. Pangadaman Cazar. Is the following description sufficient? Books of accounts, financial records, vouchers, journals, correspondence, receipts, ledgers, portfolios, credit journals, typewriters, and other documents or papers showing all business transactions including disbursement receipts, balance sheets, and related profit and loss statements. No, this amounts to a general warrant authorizing the officer to pick up anything he pleases. Stonehill versus Giocno. The search warrant described the articles sought to be seized as all printing equipment, typewriters, cabinets, tables, communications, recording, equipment used or connected in the printing of the We Firm newspaper and any other documents, communication, letters and facsimile of prints related to the We Firm newspaper. Is this description adequate? No. The sweeping tenor of the description makes the document a general warrant. The military applied for a search warrant for two addresses of the newspaper, W. Firm, 728 units, C&D, RMS, Building Quezon Avenue, Quezon City, and number 19, Road 3, Project 6, Quezon City. Two warrants were issued, both of them referring to the Project 6 address. Search nonetheless was made at the RMS building address. The search of the latter is thought to be invalidated on the ground that the place was not sufficiently described. Decide. The defect pointed out is obviously a typographical error. In determining the sufficiency of the description of the address, the executing officer's prior knowledge of the place intended in the warrant is relevant. In this case, the executing officer was also the affiant on whose affidavit the warrant had issued. He therefore knew what addresses were referred to. Burgos, Senior versus Chief of Staff. If a warrant for the search of the place, there is a mistake in the identification of the owner of the place, does it invalidate the warrant? Not if the place is properly described. Frank Uy versus BIR. What could be referred to by the phrase searches and seizures of whatever nature and for whatever purpose? It is submitted that the phrase effectively extends the search and seizure clause to at least two penumbral areas. The first is the sub prena ducis tecum under Rule 27 of the Rules of Court, see Material Distribution versus Judge and Oklahoma Press versus Walling. The second, as yet untouched by Philippine jurisprudence, is building inspection by administrative officers, see Camara versus Municipal Court. What is the rule on examination of bank deposits? An examination of the secrecy of bank deposits law, RA number 1405, would reveal the following allowable exceptions: where the depositor consents in writing, impeachment case, by court order, in bribery or dereliction of duty cases against public official, deposit is subject to of litigation. Section 8, RA number 3019, in cases of unexplained wealth, as held in the case of PNB versus Gankaiko, Marquez versus Desierto, 135882. Are warrantless drugs tests in public schools allowable? In the criminal context, reasonableness usually requires showing of probable cause. The probable cause standard, however, is peculiarly related to criminal investigations and may be unsuited to determining the reasonableness of administrative searches where the government seeks to prevent the development of hazardous conditions. The American court has held that a warrant and finding of probable cause are unnecessary in the public school context because such requirements would unduly interfere with the maintenance of swift and informal disciplinary procedures that are needed. Bernonia versus Acton, Board of Education versus Earls, RA 9165, otherwise known as the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act of 2002, requires mandatory drug testing of candidates for public office, students of secondary and tertiary schools, officers and employees of public and private offices, and persons charged before the prosecutor's office with certain offenses, among other personalities. As applied to candidates for national office, the requirement is unconstitutional because it adds to the exclusive qualification for such offices prescribed by the Constitution. As applied to students following U.S. jurisprudence, the court upheld the law for the reasons that schools and their administrators stand in loco parentis with respect to their students. 2. Minor students have contextually fewer rights than an adult and are subject to the custody and supervision of their parents, guardians, and schools. 3. Schools acting in loco parentis have a duty to safeguard the health and well-being of their students and may adopt such measures as may reasonably be necessary to discharge such duty. And 4. Schools have the right to impose conditions on applicants for admission that are fair, just, and non-discriminatory. Essentially, this is the reasonable test. As to employees, the reasonable test was applied. As to candidates for local office, the mandatory character was found to be unreasonable and oppressive to privacy. Similarly, it was declared unconstitutional for people charged before the prosecutor's office. Social Justice Society versus Dangerous Drugs Board. Note, the Constitution and the rules of court prescribe particular requirements attaching to search warrants. These are not imposed by the AMLA with respect to bank inquiry orders. A constitutional warrant requires that the judge personally examine under oath or affirmation the complainant and the witnesses he may produce such examination being in the form of searching questions and answers. Those are impositions which the legislative did not prescribe to the bank inquiry order under the AMLA. Simply put, a bank inquiry order is not a search warrant or warrant of arrest, as it contemplates a direct object but not the seizure of persons or property. Republic versus Eugenio, GR number 174629. What is the consequence of a search seizure without a warrant by authority of an invalid warrant? Any evidence obtained in such search or seizure shall be inadmissible for any purposes in any proceeding. Article 3, Section 3, Number 2, the Constitution explicitly follows the exclusionary rule. Does an application for bail have the effect of waiver of the right to challenge the validity of a warrant? No. Section 26, Rule 114 of the Revised Rules on Criminal Procedure is a new one, intended to modify previous rulings of this court that an application for bail or the admission to bail by the accused shall be considered as a waiver of his right to assail the warrant issued for his arrest on the legalities or irregularities thereon. The new rule reverted to the ruling of this court in People v. Red. The new rule is curative in nature because precisely it was designed to supply defects and curb evils in procedural rules. Okabe v. Judge De Leon. Are firearms which have been illegally seized in a zona admissible in evidence? No. Pending determination of the legality of such articles, however, they shall remain in custodia legis, subject to such appropriate disposition of the corresponding courts may decide. Ali v. Castro. Must goods illegally seized be returned? Yes, unless the possession of such goods is prohibited by law. Castro v. Judge Pabalan. Petitioner was the owner of a motorcycle suspected to be the getaway vehicle of the assailant of the late Moises Espinosa. It was seized 2 days after the killing in the house of petitioner. There was no warrant for the seizure. When petitioner sought to recover the vehicle, police claimed that it was needed for the prosecution. Comment. It must be returned. The fact that it might be needed for the prosecution of an important crime is no exception to the rule on warrants. Bagalihog v. Fernandez. Who may avail of the defense of an unlawful search or seizure? The objection to an unlawful search or seizure and to evidence obtained thereby is purely personal and cannot be availed by third parties. Is it required that the property to be searched should be owned by the person against whom the search warrant is directed? No. It is sufficient that the property is under the control or possession of the person sought to be searched. Is every warrantless search an illegal search? No, according to People v. Aruta. Warrantless search, incidental to a lawful arrest recognized under Section 12, Rule 16 of the Rules of Court, and by prevailing jurisprudence. But the tests for a valid warrantless search incidental to a lawful arrest are 1. The item to be searched was within the arrestee's custody or area of immediate control. United States v. Chorazon. 2. The search was contemporaneous with the arrest. Shipley v. California. Seizure of evidence in plain view. The requisite for this are the elements of which are 1. A prior valid intrusion into a place. 2. The evidence was inadvertently discovered by the police who had the right to be where they are. 3. The illegality of the evidence must be immediately apparent. And 4. And is noticed without further search. People v. Evaristo. Search of a moving vehicle. Highly regulated by the government, the vehicle's inherent mobility reduces expectation of privacy, but there must be a highly reasonable suspicion amounting to probable cause that the occupant committed a criminal activity. Consented warrantless search. De Garcia v. Loxine. But it must appear first that the right exists, secondly, that the person involved had knowledge either actual or constructive of the existence of such right. Lastly, that said person had an actual intention to relinquish the right. Thus, where the accused has voluntarily surrendered his gun, he cannot claim illegality of the seizure. People v. Agbot. Customs search or seizure of goods concealed to avoid duties. Uketin v. Villarreal. Stop and frisk situation. See below. Exigent and emergency circumstances. See below. Where is the below? What is the stop-frisk rule? The U.S. Supreme Court laid down stop-and-frisk as an instance of a valid warrantless search in Terry v. Ohio. The Philippine Supreme Court adopted it in Posadas v. Court of Appeals. Subsequently, the court notably applied it in the following cases, People v. Sulayel, Malacat v. Court of Appeals. The rule is stated thus by Terry, where a police officer observes unusual conduct which leads him reasonably to conclude in light of his experience criminal activity may be afoot and that the person with whom he is dealing may be armed and presently dangerous, where in the course of investigation of his behavior he identifies himself as a policeman and makes reasonable inquiries, and where nothing in the initial stages of the encounter serves to dispel his reasonable fear for his own or others' safety, he is entitled for the protection of himself and others in the area to conduct a careful limited search of the outer clothing of such person in an attempt to discover weapons which might be used to assault him. Such a search is reasonable search under the Fourth Amendment, Malacat 283 Squaw, In Malacca, the court discussed the justification for an allowable scope of a stop and frisk as a limited protective search of outer clothing for weapons. Thus, the court said that while probable cause is not required to conduct a stop and frisk, it nevertheless holds that mere suspicion or a hunch will not validate a stop and frisk. A genuine reason must exist in light of the police officer's experience and surrounding conditions to warrant the belief that the person detained has weapons concealed about him. Finally, a stop and frisk serves a twofold interest. 1. The general interest of effective crime prevention and detection, which underlies the recognition that a police officer may, under appropriate circumstances and in an appropriate manner, approach a person for purposes of investigating possible criminal behavior, even without probable cause, and 2. The more pressing interests of safety and self-preservation, which permit the police officer to take steps to assure himself that the person with whom he deals is not armed with a deadly weapon that could unexpectedly and fatally be used against the police officer. Malacca, 283, Scra, 17677. Illustrate the warrantless search arising from exigent circumstance. This was applied in People v. De Gracia, GR 102009, where there was intelligence report that the building was being used as headquarters by the RUM during the 1989 coup d'etat. Surveillance indicated rebels' activities in the building. Nearby courts were closed and general chaos and disorder prevailed. Under the situation then prevailing, the raiding team had no opportunity to apply for and secure a search warrant from the court. Under such urgency and exigency of the moment, a search warrant should lawfully be dispensed with. Police operatives went to Samora and Pandacan Street, Manila, to confirm reports of drug pushing in the area. They saw E selling something to another person. After the latter had left, they approached E, introduced themselves as policemen, and frisked him. The search yielded 2 plastic cellophane tea bags of marijuana. When asked if he had more, he replied that there were more in his house. The policemen went to his house, where they found 10 more cellophane tea bags of marijuana. E was charged with and convicted of possession of prohibited drugs. E assails the admissibility in evidence of the seized tea bags. Besides, the articles seized from E during his arrest were valid under the doctrine of search made incidental to a lawful arrest. The warrantless search made in his house, however, which yielded 10 cellophane bags of marijuana, became unlawful since the police officer were not armed with a search warrant at that time. Moreover, it was beyond the reach and control of E. España versus Court of Appeals. Do these exceptions declare a field day for searching officers? No, because the essential requisite of probable cause, except in stop and frisk, must still be satisfied before a warrantless search and seizure can be lawfully conducted. People v. Aruta. Probable cause in these cases must only be based on reasonable ground of suspicion or belief that a crime had been committed or is about to be committed, as determined by the searching officer. May a fishing vessel found to be violating fishery laws be seized without a warrant? Yes, on 2 grounds. 1. Because they are usually equipped with powerful motors that enable them to elude pursuit, and 2. Because the seizure would be incidental to the lawful arrest of the crew. Rolton Jr. v. Aria. Convicted by the RTC of illegal fishing, petitioner contends that the NBI finding of sodium cyanide in the fish specimens should not have been admitted because the fish samples were seized from their fishing vessels without a search warrant. Decide. This is a case of search of moving vehicle, Hisson versus Court of Appeals. 20 meters from the gate of the Batasan, a truck was stopped and searched. The motorist had not given any evidence of suspicious behavior, nor had the searching officers received any confidential information about the car. Could the search be justified as a warrantless search of a moving vehicle? No, there was no probable cause. Aniag Jr. v. Commission on Elections. On the basis of a tip, accused was arrested and searched upon disembarking from MV Wilcon in Iloilo City. The detention and search yielded marijuana. The officer were not armed with a warrant. Although the officer had at least 2 days to obtain a warrant, was the search and seizure valid? No. The officers had all the time to obtain a warrant. People versus Aminuddin. Accused Malmsted was a passenger on a bus from Sagada to Baguio City, which was stopped at a checkpoint in Camp Tangwa. The checkpoint was set up on the basis of reports that vehicles from the Sagada were being used to transport marijuana. Moreover, information had been received that a Caucasian coming from Sagada had prohibited in his possession. During the inspection, officers noticed a bulge in accused's waist. When accused refused to comply with the request of identification papers, he was made to show what he had on his waist. It was found that it contained hashish. On stepping outside, accused stopped to pick up two traveling bags, which, upon being opened, were also found to contain prohibited drugs. Accused claimed illegal search. Decide. The search was made as an incidental to his arrest when he was found in possession of illegal drugs. The arrest was made on probable cause that he was committing a crime. The warrantless search of the bus was a valid search of a moving vehicle. People versus Malmsted. Upon arrival at Taneia after boarding a taxi, defendant's vehicle was stopped by the PC after a tip from a deep penetration agent. Of the arrival of the defendants with methamphetamine or shabu, defendants allege that it is an illegal search as the PC knew 2 days in advance of their arrival and yet did not obtain a search warrant. It is a legal search falling under the exception of search of a moving vehicle, People versus Lo Ho Wing. Upon a warrantless search of a hotel room, consent was given and voluntary surrender of papers belonging to the registered but absent occupant was given by a woman identified as the wife of the occupant, but who in fact was a mere manicurist. Was such consent sufficient to justify a warrantless search? Yes. The officers of the law cannot be blamed if they would act on the appearances. There was a person inside who, from all indication, was ready to accede to their request. Even ordinary courtesy would preclude them from inquiring too closely as to why she was there. Lopez versus Commissioner of Customs. If the right against unreasonable search and seizure is a personal right, may it be waived by somebody other than the person himself? Note, a permission granted for officers to enter a house to look for rebel soldiers does not include permission for a room-to-room search for firearms. Spouses Bureau v. Layague. Note, where marijuana sticks fall before the eyes of a police officer from an object a person is carrying, seizure of the sticks would not require a warrant. They were evidence in plain view. People versus Tabor. Where, however, police officers find an object only after making some search, the plain view rule cannot be applied. Is every warrantless arrest illegal? No. Rule 113, Section 5, Rules of Court, summarizes the exception, does. A peace officer or a private person may, without warrant, arrest a person. A. When, in his presence, the person to be arrested has committed, is actually committing, or attempting to commit an offense. B. When an offense has in fact been committed and he has personal knowledge of facts indicating that the person to be arrested has committed it. And C. When the person to be arrested is a prisoner who has escaped from a penal establishment or place where he is serving final judgment or temporary confined while his case is pending, or has escaped while being transferred from one confinement to another. Appellant assails as unconstitutional the manner in which the so-called bypass operation is conducted in order to enforce the Dangerous Drugs Act. He stigmatizes it as no different from seizure of evidence from one's person or abode without search warrant. Comment. A bypass operation is a form of entrapment. The method is an officer to pose as a buyer. He, however, neither instigates nor induces the accused to commit a crime, because in these cases, the seller has already decided to commit a crime. And since the offense happens right before the eyes of the officer, there is no need for a warrant, either for the seizure of the goods or for the apprehension of the offender. People versus De La Cruz. What is entrapment and when is it allowed? It is recognized that in every arrest, there is a certain amount of entrapment used to outwit the persons violating or about to violate the law. Not every deception is forbidden. The type of entrapment the law forbids is the inducing of another to violate the law, the seduction of an otherwise innocent person into a criminal career. Where the criminal intent originates in the mind of the entrapping person, and the accused is lured into the commission of the offense charged in order to prosecute him, there is entrapment, and no conviction may be had. Where, however, the criminal intent originates in the mind of the accused, and the criminal offense is completed, the fact that a person acting as a decoy for the state or public official furnished the accused an opportunity for commission of the offense, or that the accused is aided in the commission of the crime in order to secure the evidence necessary to prosecute him, there is no entrapment, and the accused must be convicted. The law tolerates the use of decoys and other artifices to catch a criminal. People v. Doria. 125-299. A surveillance team of police officers saw two men looking from side to side, and one of them holding his abdomen. When approached, the two men ran away, but were caught. When searched, they yielded a 38 caliber Smith and Wesson revolver with 6 live bullets in the chamber. The weapons were taken, given to the police, who used it as evidence in a prosecution for possession of an unlicensed firearm. Was the warrantless arrest and search valid? The court ruled the evidence inadmissible, saying that no offense was involved in looking from side to side and holding the abdomen. People v. Mengote. GR 87059. This is not a stop and frisk situation. From a report, a police officer hears of the recent commission of a crime. Does such knowledge justify a warrantless arrest? No. Regarding Section 5, Letter B, it is not enough that there is reasonable ground to believe that the person to be arrested has committed a crime. A crime must, in fact, or actually have been committed first. That a crime has been committed is an essential precondition, and the arresting officer must have personal knowledge of the commission of the crime. Go versus Court of Appeals. Moreover, an arrest made in 19 hours after the offense had been committed cannot be of one whose crime in fact has just been committed. People versus Manlulu. While patrolling in their car, policemen received a radio message from their camp directing them to proceed to Ihau Ihau, where there had been a shooting. They went to the place and they saw the victim. Bystanders pointed to the accused as the assailant. The accused by then was fleeing, but had not gone very far from the place. The police officers arrested the accused and seized the gun from him. Valid warrantless arrest and search? A valid warrantless arrest under Rule 113B, number Section 5, an offense has in fact just been committed, and the officers had personal knowledge of the facts indicating that the accused had committed it. Valid warrantless search and under Rule 126, Section 12, search incidental to a lawful arrest. People v. Jason. 120330. Must a police officer who mistakenly arrests a person on the ground of being in flagrante delicto be made liable? For the arrest of one in flagrante delicto to be valid under Rule 112, Section 5, number letter A, the law tilts in favor of authority. Thus, speech with in an officer's estimation is criminally seditious can justify warrantless arrest in flagrante delicto, even if upon prosecution the officer is proved wrong. The criminal character of speech is something that is not easily determined and must await court estimation. Espiritu v. Lim, GR 85727. May a person charged with rebellion, subversion, conspiracy, or proposal to commit such crimes, and crimes or offenses committed in furtherance thereof be arrested without a warrant? Yes, since these are continuing offenses, and therefore the accused are assumed to be always continuing the offense. Umil and Dural v. Fidel Ramos. The decision was a reaffirmation of the notorious Garcia Padilla v. Enrile, reaffirmed on reconsideration in Re Umo, October 3, 1991. Armed with a search warrant, elements of PCINP conducted a raid at a residence where they found several people in conference who scampered in different directions, leaving behind subversive materials of various kinds, a 38 caliber revolver, assorted ammunition, money, medicine, and printing paraphernalia. The persons there and then were arrested. Was the arrest legal? Yes. This is arrest of persons actually committing a crime, justified even without warrant under Rule 113, Section 6, Letter A, Garcia Padilla versus Enrile, GR 61388. The accused raised the issue of the irregularity of his arrest only during trial. Will it prosper? No. Any objection involving a warrant of arrest or procedure in the acquisition by the court of jurisdiction over the person of the accused must be made before he enters his plea. Otherwise, the objection is deemed waived. People versus Cabiles, GR number 112035, January 16, 1998. When is the accused stopped from assailing the illegality of his arrest? Jurisprudence is settled that an accused is stopped from assailing the illegality of his arrest if he fails to move for the quashing of the information against him before his arraignment. People versus Hernandez. Section 3. The privacy of communication and correspondence shall be inviolable except upon lawful order of the court or when public safety or order requires otherwise as prescribed by law. 2. Any evidence obtained in violation of this or the preceding section shall be inadmissible for any purpose in any proceeding. What is the reason for the Section 3, Number 1? When the 1935 Constitution was being formulated, the controlling doctrine was that the search and seizure clause did not prohibit non-trespassory wiretaps. This was the doctrine established in 1928 in Olmsted v. United States. Briefly, the argument in Olmsted was that where there is no physical trespass, there is no search, and where the object is not tangible, it cannot be seized. The tangibles only rule was anchored on the text of the Fourth Amendment, which enumerates tangibles, house, person, papers, effects. The framers of the 1935 Constitution were quite aware of the Olmsted Doctrine and their realization of the inadequacy of the search and seizure clause as a protection for personal privacy must have at least partly motivated the adoption of the privacy policy. It has no counterpart in the American Constitution nor in earlier Philippine organic law. In effect, the privacy provision anticipated future development of American jurisprudence, for in 1967, Katz v. United States overruled the Olmsted Doctrine and placed wiretapping with or without physical trespass under the ban of the search and seizure clause. What forms of correspondence and communication are covered by this provision? It covers letters, messages, telephone calls, telegrams, and the like. When is intrusion into the privacy of communication and correspondence allowed? It is allowed upon lawful order of the court or when public safety or order requires otherwise as prescribed by law. Upon what grounds may a court allow intrusion? The text does not give any ground. It is submitted that the requirement of probable cause in the preceding section should be followed. After all, as may be seen in the development of American jurisprudence on the subject, the privacy right is but an aspect of the right to be secure in one's person. CF Material Distributor versus Natividad. Should the order also particularly describe the communication or correspondence sought to be seized? When the correspondence sought is written correspondence, it would seem that there should be no inconvenience in requiring particularity of description. But if the intrusion is to be done through wiretaps, how is the description to be made? Evidently, it would be impossible to describe the contents of a communication that has not yet been made. Hence, it would be unreasonable to require a description of the contents of the communication, but the identity of the person or persons whose communication is to be intercepted, and the identity of offense or offenses sought to be prevented, and the period of the authorization given can be specified. In fact, an attempt in this direction is made by Section 3 of RA 4200, the Anti-Wiretaping Law, and similar safeguards are also found in the Title 3 of the Omnibus Crime Control and Safe Streets Act, Section 2518, which was discussed in the wiretaping case of United States versus U.S. District. What are the requisites when intrusion is made without judicial order? When intrusion is made without a judicial order, it would have to be based upon a government official's assessment that public safety and order demand such intrusion. In addition to what has been said about what transpired at the 1935 convention, It was also made clear in the 1972 convention that an executive officer can order intrusion when, in his judgment and even without prior court approval, he believes that public safety or order so requires, and public order and safety were defined as the security of human lives, liberty, and property against activities of invaders, insurrectionists, and rebels, 1971 Constitution Convention. Direction of the public officer, moreover, must be exercised as prescribed by law. This is a phrase added to the 1973 version of the new Constitution. It should also be added that the exercise of this power by an executive officer is subject to judicial review. Moreover, other than the president, who may be deemed to have this power because under the Constitution he is charged with the exercise of executive power, other executive officers should first be properly authorized. To hold otherwise would be to opt for government of men and not of laws. Every police agent would feel authorized to snoop. Is there any implementing statute covering this subject? Yes, RA 4200, known as the anti-wiretaping law, provides penalties for specific violations of private communication. Note that Section 3 of the Act allows court-authorized taps under specific condition for the crimes of treason, espionage, provoking war and disloyalty in case of war, piracy, mutiny in the high seas, rebellion, conspiracy and proposal to commit rebellion, inciting rebellion, sedition, conspiracy to commit sedition, inciting to sedition, and kidnapping. What is the effect of violation of Section 2 and 3? Any evidence obtained shall be inadmissible for any purpose in any proceeding, as already discussed in the preceding section. However, this defense is purely personal. Mr. Job Reyes, proprietor of Manila Packing Export Forwarders, a private firm, opened boxes of Andre Martin for final inspection as part of standard operating procedure before delivery to the Bureau of Post or Customs. Reyes found dried marijuana leaves inside and took samples to the NBI, who verified that the dried leaves were marijuana leaves. An information was filed against Martin for a violation of RA 6425 of the Dangerous Drugs Act. Martin says that the marijuana leaves are fruits of an illegal search and therefore under the exclusionary rule of Section 3.2 of the Bill of Rights. Can an act of a private individual allegedly in violation of appellant's constitutional right be invoked against the state? No. In the absence of governmental interference, the constitutional right against unreasonable search and seizure, can it be invoked against the state? The protection against unreasonable search and seizure cannot be extended to acts committed by private individuals so as to bring it within the ambit of alleged unlawful intrusion by the government. People v. Andre Martin, GR number 81561. Any firearms which have been illegally seized in a zona admissible in evidence? No. Pending determination of the legality of such articles, however, they shall remain in custodio legis, subject to such appropriate disposition as the corresponding courts may decide. Ali v. Castro. Note, Section 26, Rule 114 of the Revised Rules in Criminal Procedure says that an application for bail or the admission of bail by an accused is not considered a waiver of his right to assail the warrant issued for his arrest or the legalities or irregularities thereof. This is a new rule intended to modify previous rulings of this court. The new rule is curative in nature because precisely it is designed to supply defects and curb evils in procedural rules, Okabe v. Judge de Leon. But it is long settled that where the accused by his voluntary submission to the jurisdiction of the court, as shown by the counsel-assisted plea he entered during the arraignment and his active participation in the trial thereafter, voluntarily waives his constitutional protection against illegal arrests and searches, we have consistently ruled that any objection concerning the issue of service of a warrant or a procedure and the acquisition of the court of jurisdiction over the person of the accused must be made before he enters his plea. Otherwise, the objection is deemed waived. People v. Rivera.